So AtGames went and rolled out not one, but two firmware updates this week, both of amazing significance, and let's go ahead and talk about some of these great new features we got with these firmware updates in today's video. So definitely one of the most amazing updates we've got via any kind of firmware update thus far on the AtGames Legends Ultimate Arcade cabinet is this open beta Bluetooth application client. So first things first, you need to go to the ArcadeNet website, download the firmware for this open beta client, and then once you've got that installed on your cabinet, you're going to come over here to settings, and you're going to select your Bluetooth client, and it's going to bring up this menu, and you're going to make sure it says Bluetooth client up here and not Bluetooth host, and we're going to hit apply. And once we do that, it's going to start a countdown from 180 seconds, basically giving us 3 minutes to pair it, our control deck, with our Raspberry Pi, or in my case, the Odroid XU4. Personally, what I prefer to play with, just because they're a little more powerful than Raspberry Pi, and they allow me to play a wider variety of games. But once we've done that, I've got my Odroid XU4 plugged into my HDMI port. I'm just going to move my selection, hitting the source button on the control panel, going over to my RetroPi / Odroid menu. I've got a RetroPi image burned onto my SD card for my XU4, so I'm going to use my PlayStation 4 gamepad that I'm currently using to navigate the menu. And I'm going to go into the RetroPi configurations. I'm going to find the Bluetooth section and select it. We're going to go into the Bluetooth submenu now. And we're going to do register and connect a Bluetooth device. So it's going to search, and it's probably going to pull up any Bluetooth things I've got turned on in the house right now, like my PC, phone in my pocket, probably my wife's phone as well. But we're going to be looking for something that's called something very similar to what our firmware was, the HA8800, I think it was. And depending on your Bluetooth connectivity and all that kind of stuff, it'll take longer for certain people. So your mileage may vary. This is just how you set it up with RetroPi. If you're wanting to pair it with a PC, obviously it's going to be a little different, but it is doable. I've seen several people already doing that right now, so very cool feature. But here we go. It's picked up everything, phones, my camera, but we're looking for the HA8800. So we're going to select it. This is a secondary menu I have to go through. You may or may not have this menu, but I'm just going to hit yes here. And it says we've successfully connected. So I'm going to hit OK. And I'm going to back out. And then last thing we have to do is we need to configure our control panel. So I'm going to hit Start. And I'm going to go into Configure Input. And it should bring up two configurations or two sources detected. The gamepad I'm using right now to navigate the menu. And then the control deck itself. So we're going to select it. Are we sure? Yes. And then now we can configure our control panel. So put the controller down. I'm going to now use the control deck. I'm going to hold A. Now I'm going to hit up on the keyboard, or excuse me, on my joystick. Down, left, right, start button. I'm going to hit start. Select button. I'm going to hit rewind. You can configure this however you want. This is just how I'm going to set it up. My personal preferences. Play with it however you like. A for A. I'm going to hit Z for the left shoulder, and C for the right shoulder. And then for the buttons I do not have, I'm just going to do long presses on the button A. So if you've ever messed with RetroPi, you're familiar with this. If not, like I said, I'm just holding the A button until it says not defined. I'm going to get all the way down to the bottom. And then our hotkey. This is what we're going to use with start to back out of any of the games in the menu. You can set it to whatever you want. I'm just going to select the menu button because it's right next to my start button. And hit OK. Now I'm going to hit back. Oh, excuse me. It's going to configure my input. It's going to have a little seizure. I'm going to hit the back button, which is now my B. And then now I have access and control over my Odroid. And the image I have here, I've got like 8,000 games. It's a little bit of everything. Everything from consoles to arcades, Super Nintendo, Virtual Boy. I mean, there's, 8,000 games, 3DO, 2,000 arcade games, every Atari game. We got some Atomos Wave. Again, this is why I prefer the Odroid over the Raspberry Pi is just the ability to play some more advanced systems, Dreamcast, PlayStation, Game Boy, Sega, Nintendo 64 works absolutely well on here. Sega Naomi, Neo Geo, of course, NES, I mean, you name it, PSP, PlayStation, Sega Saturn, we got it all on here. So let's go ahead and do Nintendo 64 real quick. Obviously, controls are not going to be ideal, but functionality and playability, it'll work. Won't be ideal because I've only got six action buttons, and obviously the Nintendo 64 controller was configured to have more buttons than the six action buttons that I got here. So we'll play it the best we can. We'll see what buttons we end up sacrificing and if it's a deal breaker on being able to play this right now, but we'll give it a shot. We'll give it the old college try. I'll just go into a real quick exhibition match. Not really caring about who we're going with. We'll get The Undertaker versus Chris Jericho. Best wrestling game ever made, by the way. This is what I wish all wrestling games would have, this foundation and the system behind, with the Aki and the THQ kind of backing. I wish they all had this kind of functionality. Unfortunately, we don't have that anymore with wrestling games in the modern era. They're all pretty crappy. All right, we don't need to see. Come on, let's just get right to the action. Using my joystick, controlling my character. Punch button. All right, that's working. Good. Giving him the business. Uh-oh. And he's trying to reverse me right out of the gate. Of course he is. Kind of spamming buttons right now just because I'm trying to figure out the layout. So Z is back up. C is block. Okay. Yeah. Definitely a little difficult not having some of these buttons, mainly like a run button. I think it was like the down or the left yellow arrow on the Nintendo 64 controller. Definitely don't have that right now. But still able to play this game. And as you can see, it's running perfectly well. So let's back out, test another game real quick. All right, let's test out some Sega Naomi, however you want to call it. Yeah, let's play some Virtual Athlete. This is essentially a super modern version of track and field. You're definitely going to feel the forearm burn trying to rapidly hit these buttons. I know I'm going to be absolutely terrible at this game, but the fact that I can play it, that's the impressive thing right here. Not so much my gameplay, just the game playing. Go ahead. Wait for it to load up. There we go. Yeah, let's be Bruce Lindsay, USA. Nobody else is playing. Let's go. Too javelin. See if I can figure out just how to throw something. I think probably running and jumping is probably a little too complicated for my abilities to play this game right now. All right, so we're just gonna rapidly smash the buttons. Problem is, I don't know what color lines up with these, so I'm just gonna be hitting buttons and hoping for the best. Ideal angle, 45 degrees. Okay, so yeah, this is very similar to track and field. It's time to introduce the athletes. Please put the competing. All right, trying to go for 75 meters. That seems excessive. Come on, Bruce! Ah, oh, stepped over the line. You gotta hold it back, Bruce. You gotta. I mean, at least I threw it. That was impressive. Let's try again. Just smashing the B and C button as hard as I can, just get that speed up. Oh, come on, Bruce. Dang it, I gotta figure out that release point a little better. Well, it's all or nothing, Bruce, right now. You gotta throw it 75 just to get in there. Come on, go. Oh, that's gonna be short. That's a bad angle. All right, we didn't make it. But the game works. Let's back out. Try something else. All right, let's go do some arcade games, of course. Got over 2,000, so it's gonna be a little difficult to like weed through here, so I'm just kinda like randomly scroll through, but we just got options galore. Yeah, let's do Power Battle. Always love Mega Man. Great arcade game if you're not familiar with it. Highly recommend you check it out. We Mega Man. Going against Shadow Man. Oh. Where's my... There it is. Took me a second to figure out what my blaster button was. Let's play one more game and then we'll talk about the other amazing features we got going on with these new firmware updates. Back. Yeah, Thomas Wave. Play Dolphin Blue. Metal Gear Slug with dolphins. Basically, I mean, it's a great game, but it's kind of crazy how similar it is to the Metal Slug series. Good old Thomas Wave. Go. As you can see, the graphics are much, much impressed with the 2.5D visuals and things like that. This is why I like the Odroids over the Raspberry Pi, so I can play things like this. I'm getting on the Dolphin. Action-packed game. Guys are just defying all laws of gravity and physics, just floating up there. Alright, let's talk about some other features. So with the first firmware update that we got earlier in the week, it got a little overshadowed by the Bluetooth client and the connectivity of the Raspberry Pi, the Odroid, and things like that. But there's some amazing features that you guys really need to be aware of in case you missed out on this one. So, number one, the first thing is we now have online competitive multiplayer and co-op on the ArcadeNet games. So once you've got the newest firmware update downloaded, you're gonna notice new icon logos of little clouds next to your games. Now these are games that you can play with a friend or against a friend across the internet. Very cool feature. I'm not really gonna do a tutorial because this video is already long enough, but if you wanna see the ins and outs on how to get this up and running and how it works, I highly suggest you check out the Tech Buzz's video. They did a great job playing Glenn from Glenn's Retro Show online on some of these games. Really cool feature, but definitely worth checking out. Basically, you just add a friends list, add a friend, decide what game you guys want to play, and then boom, you're set up, you're ready to go. Obviously, your friend has to have their own cabinet, but it's amazing feature, something I never thought in a million years we'd see, something I always dreamed about as a kid, being able to play some of these arcade classics against friends, you know, that weren't gonna go to the arcade with me. So that's one amazing feature. Another amazing feature we had is this online leaderboards for Burger Time. This is the first game they're doing it right now. This is gonna be a feature that will be mini games probably in the future, but right now it's just for Burger Time. So let me show you what that looks like. So I think I had it. Let's just find it real quick. Burger Time. So the Burger Time arcade now records your high scores and saves them online to an online leaderboard as well as internally on the system. But you can competitively go for some high score ranking, and you can track the leaderboards online at the ArcadeNet website. And there'll be prizes, supposedly, for people that win the highest score in a given time frame. But it's very cool. If you want to see how it works, you select the game, Burger Time Arcade. We got here, and you're going to see this X button ranking. We're going to hit that. It's going to bring up the leaderboards that are existing right now. So here are the top five people that have recorded some Burger Time high scores. If you want to see the full list of everybody that's recorded a high score, you can go online and check that, as well as you can check all your own high scores. But right now, like I said, it's only working for Burger Time. Very cool feature though. Nice to see that, you know, competitive high score streak is still alive. You got some usernames here, at TG Beam, it's got over 1 million points. Camaro 748 has over 1 million points too. Third place, Allen at 188,000. So there's definitely some people that really know what they're doing. Shows their initials and everything. Very cool feature. And then lastly, they actually improved a lot of the graphics on the Vector games with this update. So go to Tempest. So the Vector games looked a little wishy-washy as far as the brightness of the image on the original firmware update. But now we've got a little more improved graphic, in my opinion. It's not going to blow your mind or anything, but this is much more in line with what it looked like. Obviously, we've got an LCD screen, but Tempest looks much better, in my opinion, as I die instantly because I'm not paying attention. But I'm really happy to see these improved graphics. You don't have to go into any settings or tweak anything to get it. So we still got our same functionality. We got our new pixel perfect, what I prefer to play these games on, scanline filter, everything. But the graphics themselves, much improved. Loads of great features on these new firmware updates. Highly recommend you check them out this weekend or whenever you're getting your Legends Ultimate Arcade cabinet. And that does it for today's video. Guys, if you have further ideas or suggestions that you want to see implemented on a future firmware update on this AtGames Legends Ultimate Arcade cabinet, feel free to shoot them an email at arcadeideas@atgames.net. If you're new to this channel, please consider subscribing. Make sure you hit that notification bell so you'll be the first to know every time I upload great content like this. And as always, thanks for watching, guys. It really means a lot.